So you know what? We're not selling it now.
Backstage in Cincinnati, Goldberg chats with one of the hottest athletes of the moment, Wally Szczerbiak from Miami of Ohio. The night after leading his school to the NCAA Sweet 16, Szczerbiak is a fan.
I respect the athletes out there because they're really true athletes, and some of the stuff that they do is unmatchable, you know, even in a lot of sports. So it's something I enjoy watching for entertainment.
I think we out-cartoon the cartoons. We out-talk the talk shows. I think we out-action the action adventures.
I see wrestling as kind of a 90s version of a morality play.
Can attack.
Joe Gulla, how you doing? Johnny Rodeo. I got to talk to you for a minute, man. Forget the Archangels. I want to manage the House of Pain, Joe.
Let me tell you something. Don't even think that you have what
Just beat it, bitch.
He set me up, Rodeo. You're dead meat when I get you, Rodeo, brother.
Moments later, the teams reassemble to discuss what are called spots, specific points of action in the match they are about to have. The run-through helps the finished product look more realistic.
What we're going to do is tag, throw him off the ropes. He's going to come off. We're going to body press him, drop him.
I'll pick you up. I'll work on the shoulder.
That's it. Put the boots to him.
Throw a punch. You can take me down.
And then I'll wrap my legs around it.
Submission.
Oh, my submission. God. I got to worry about permanent damage. Oh, for God's sakes. You can hear the screaming at ringside. He has submitted. He's tapping out. It's over. It's over. The Archangels.
The match goes off as planned. The House of Pain lost their title belts. Joe Gulla's surgery has now been written into his resume.
You messed with the wrong person.
The winners, the losers, the champs and the chumps. The storylines are all created at the booking meetings that go on in every wrestling company. Angles on who's the good babyface, who's the evil heel, how to get crowd support or heat for a wrestler to get him over, more popular with the audience.
Watching you guys talk this through and figure this thing out, sort of draw.
They simulate sex. They flash flesh. They flip the bird.
Oh, my.
15 years. After you do that, if you want to say I'm on steroids, then you can. But until you try that, don't say it.
But when Buff Bagwell and his partner, Scott Steiner, display their muscles, many fans do say it.
Brian Pillman, nicknamed the Loose Cannon and Flying Brian, was known for his flamboyance and high-flying kicks.
Nitro, as well as that special challenge match, Hair versus Mask Larry. It's going to be Psychosis putting his mask on the line against the Hair of Kidman. And, you know, Larry, my Spanish may not be perfect by any means, but judging from what I heard Psychosis say and judging from his body language on Monday night, sure that Psychosis willingly would have put his mask on the line against Kidman.
Wait, are you saying that Psychosis didn't know what Chavo Guerrero was talking about, what he was saying?
That's exactly what I'm saying, that Chavo may have taken things just a step further than Psychosis had in mind.
It's too late now. The Hair and the mask are on the line.
The match has been signed. The match is set for this upcoming Monday's Nitro. Yes.
So if Kidman loses, he's going to want a mask.
A very good close-up look at this young man, Kidman, because after Monday's Nitro in Atlanta, Georgia, we may never see him look the same again. You know, I'm just wondering, Larry.
Well, looking at his hair now, I mean, a haircut wouldn't hurt. I mean, hair is a great handle. You control the head, you control the body. And when I got in the ring with guys with long hair, first thing I do is wrap my hand in it, just yank them around. I mean, we'll find out Monday. It's an interesting scenario. And, well, you're the professor. You delve in to find out if Psychosis knows exactly what he got into.
Well, I think one of the most interesting considerations has to be a bald Kidman. You think that might affect his success rate in chasing women as a member of the Filthy Animals faction of WCW?
Well, women chasing him. I mean, look at the bright side. He could save a fortune.
Of course, in that tag team matchup this past Monday, it was Psychosis scoring the pinfall win in the tag match over Kidman. And we all know Psychosis is a former WCW World Cruiserweight Champion, and in the fact that he's putting his identity. And you know how important that is to the luchadors, the wrestlers from Mexico. You know how important the mask is to Psychosis and the rest. He's putting that all at stake against
Kidman. Well, that's a good point, because the mask to the Mexicans is tradition. Hair to Kidman is just something he could grow back in a few months, unlike you.
Well, thank you. Kidman, one-on-one competition here against one half of the West Hollywood Blondes in Lodi. And Lodi reverses. Send Kidman off into the ropes.
Took him down, dropped toe hold down, and Lodi let him right up.
And Kidman gets back to his feet and just unleashes a vicious attack with rights and lefts to the head of Lodi that has him reeling.
But today we've seen Kidman, and Kidman can go. I mean, he doesn't fool around. Lodi leaves any room, and Kidman's going to shut the door right in his face, and there's one for him.
Follows up a drop kick with a clothesline that takes Lodi up and over. Kidman better focus his concentration on the man that he's involved with here in the matchup.
Yeah, but he took out the distraction too. Get Lenny out of the way and keep your mind focused on Lodi, which is hard to do with Lenny out there.
Telegraph the back body drop. Good Lodi. Kidman caught him with a boot.
See, look at the hand come in.
Lenny hooked him, and you see there the concentration level of Kidman as he goes to work in the back of the head of Lenny, and he leaves things wide open for Lodi to connect with the leg drop on the ring apron.
Yeah, still, I mean, with Lenny out there, Kidman just doesn't have enough eyeballs.
Lodi slowly makes his way back into the ring. Opportunity to see if he can follow up the advantage that he has. Nice snap suplex takeover, and regardless of what you think about the Blondes, as we see now the cover, the hook of the leg, the shoulders are down in a two count. Regardless of your personal opinion of the West Hollywood Blondes, there's certainly no denying the in-ring ability of both Lodi and the reigning World's Cruiserweight champ, Lenny.
Well, yeah, they're no slouches. I mean, Sting has taught us once and for all, we cannot trust anybody. Other golden rule is never underestimate anybody, pigtails or not.
Kidman connects on the clothesline. Now sends Lodi across, reversed into the ropes. Ooh, doubled him over, right hand to the midsection. And headlock drives Kidman face first to the canvas.
Looked to me like he grabbed his hair there and yanked him down.
Goes for the cover, gets two, and
go.
Referee Charles Robinson employs the count, and a two count only that time for the pinfall attempt from Lodi on Kidman. Now they're going to take it out to the floor.
See, but they, I mean, they're taking advantage of the two against one here. I mean, Lodi knew exactly where he was throwing Kidman. He took the referee out of position, and Lenny ran right in there.
Many people
well,
would tell you.
We could use some order. Many people could say we could use a president that could stop all these people hanging around the ring.
And many people would also tell you, as we see Lodi hook the leg again, get another two count before Kidman is able to escape. The outside interference on the part of either Lenny or Lodi has been a major factor in the success overall of this West Hollywood Blondes team, and it's one of the main reasons that they carry the cruiserweight gold.
I tell you, we've seen Kidman in the past, and this guy would rather pass out than give up, and he will fight to the finish. Got back to his feet. Lodi didn't have the pressure right. Kidman fought himself out of it.
Elbows to the midsection by Kidman, able to break the movement. Oh, the elbow was on target by Lodi, and it sent Kidman back out to the floor, and another opportunity for Lenny to get involved physically, but Kidman fights back.
Wait a minute, wait a minute. Lodi's on top of the buckle.
Oh, Lodi springing off the top turnbuckle, crashing down on the arena floor, and he connected with both Lenny and his opponent in this matchup, Kidman.
He certainly didn't care what happened to Lenny.
Didn't seem like it, did it? Especially if he can follow up here with a pinfall. Kidman back into the ring, going to drag him back out towards the middle. And Lodi goes back out to the ring apron.
He's wasting time. It could have went for a cover.
Wasting valuable time. Lodi to the top. Went to the guillotine leg drop. And the waste of time allowed Kidman to move out of the way and avoid the contact, as well as avoiding that clothesline. Springing off the ropes. Drives him face first. Hook of the leg. Gets two and oh, the kick out.
Couldn't hold him down.
Still fight left in Lodi.
He blocked it, laced that leg, and Kidman floated over him.
Cut him with a boot to the midsection, did Lodi. Gonna take him up, attempted a power bomb, but look at Kidman hang on. Oh, and he drove him face first, the face jam.
Hey, Kidman had his weight in the right spot, came right down on top of the head of Lodi. Lodi looks out cold as a mackerel.
Kidman up to the top rope. Oh, he just kicked off Lenny, kicked him off again. Oh, that allowed Lodi, however, to get to his feet and stop what may have been an attempt at the shooting star press, Kidman's favorite finishing move. Instead, suplex back into the ring from the middle rope by Lodi. Goes for the cover, gets one, gets two.
Couldn't hold him. Told you, Kidman will fight to the end, Mike. He will not give up here.
Now look at Lenny, back up on the ring apron.
Maybe bald Monday.
Lenny motioning for Lodi to bring him over closer. Wait a minute, who is that? That's Eddie Guerrero.
It is Eddie.
The animals are looking out for each other. Kidman got the boot up. Lodi ran right into it. Oh, great move off that middle rope. Took him over, Frankensteiner style.
Took
goes
him.
For the cover. Got two. No.
Couldn't hold him. Tell you, Lenny went, or Lodi went bouncing all over his head back. Wait a minute.
Chavo Jr. out here.
What's he doing out here?
You go with your new
Uncle
family.
Eddie takes Chavo Jr. down. There's obviously something personal between Chavo Guerrero Jr. and Kidman. There's the opening. Oh, he just ran Lodi right into Lenny.
There's the closing.
Sharp power bomb. Got one. Got two. Got him. The former multi-time WCW Cruiserweight Champ. Repeated interference. And when we return, the Harlem Heat will be interviewed here on Thunder.
Spinning splash. 1, 2, 3.
He got him.
He pinned him. He pinned him. And Evan Courageous is going to vie for the Cruiserweight title this Thursday on Thunder.
And Larry, that has to be one of the biggest victories yet in the career of this young man, Evan Courageous. He pulled out the win over Blitzkrieg this past Monday night, and as a result, he has moved into a shot at the Cruiserweight gold, and he will face Lenny of the West Hollywood Blondes later this evening, live here on Thunder.
Well, I tell you, that victory gave Mr. Courageous the biggest opportunity of his life so far, a chance to walk out of here tonight wearing very valuable gold. Cruiserweight championship is becoming a high commodity. My competition coming all over the world out of the woodwork. Tough weight division to maintain a championship.
Incredible depth when you talk about the talent roster of the WCW Cruiserweights as we see a member of the Revolution. And I point out that it is just one member of the Revolution. Perry Saturn out to do one-on-one battle with Chavo Guerrero Jr. We saw a little friction Monday on Nitro with members of the Revolution. It was a matchup with Perry Saturn against Eddie Guerrero, if you'll recall. And we saw Shane Douglas get into the ring, and he laid out Eddie Guerrero with the use of a chain. There was hesitation on the part of Perry Saturn, but the bottom line is Perry Saturn decided to go for the pinfall win, despite knowing that Shane Douglas had used the chain. Perry Saturn got the win, but he didn't seem too happy with Shane Douglas after the bout.
Saturn seemed a little disappointed, very proud man, very, you know, proud of what he's achieved. Very tough guy, great submission wrestler, but at the end, Mike, he let Douglas raise his hand. I mean, he accepted what happens. I don't know if it's maybe friction, disappointment, maybe just a clash of wills at the moment. I mean, what goes on in the heat of the passion sometimes is uncontrollable, especially for younger guys trying to get to the top of the ladder.
Seeing Chavo Guerrero Jr., the third-generation competitor, come out for this matchup with Saturn, I don't really know what to call it. Maybe it's frustration. Maybe you could even say that it's jealousy on the part of Chavo Guerrero Jr., but I think it really all boils down to his omission from that group, that faction that call themselves the Filthy Animals, and who knows, who can get in the mind of Chavo Guerrero Jr.? That may have been one of the reasons that led to his involvement this past Monday, and we even saw him come out earlier tonight in our opening matchup involving Kidman and Lodi.
You know, I've been watching Chavo Jr. here now for a couple of years, and to be honest with you, think he's a full deck player. I know all the Guerreros, they got hot tempers and they'll lose their cool, but Chavo Jr., he's a little different. He's just a little off the wall. He's not a typical Guerrero.
And as a result of Chavo playing the role of interpreter on Monday night, it will now be a mask versus hair match. Psychosis putting his mask on the line against the hair of Kidman at the Phillips Arena as Perry Saturn gets to his feet.
That Chavo Jr.'s face is going to be on the line here as Saturn keeps pounding it.
Chavo put on the brakes as Saturn tried to send him across into the ring ropes. Now Saturn shoots him across, and again he puts on the brakes and drops down and rolls out to the floor.
He's doing a smart thing. Chavo Jr.'s got great movement, but you don't want to just stand there and slug it out with Saturn.
Larry, also upcoming this Monday in Atlanta, Georgia, the beautiful new facility, the Phillips Arena, will see a six-man tag team matchup with a very unique pairing. Did you ever think that you would see Ric Flair, Bret Hart, and Hulk Hogan on one side of the ring? And to compound the matter, across the ring, they will face the trio of Diamond Dallas Page, Sting, and Lex Luger. I think it's a shock that we even have that match with those teams involved.
Yeah, unique's not the word. Shocker is more like it. Flair and Hogan and Bret Hart on the same side. No, I never thought I'd see it. How's that for a short and sweet answer?
Well, it's almost as if they have a common bond and just one common thread. And that's an all-out hatred for Sting, Lex Luger, and Diamond Dallas Page. And Perry Saturn follows up in the corner with a big boot to the face of Chavo Jr. that rocked him. Now shoots him across into the ropes. Caught him with the right hand, sitting down to the mat.
Grabbing that hair again. These guys didn't know what they're doing. No, hair's a good handle.
Chavo Jr. sends Perry to the ring ropes. Shoulder block by Saturn. Now the leap over by Saturn and the leapfrog by Chavo Jr.
He was ready for it.
Suplex released that time from Perry Saturn sends Chavo Jr. out to the floor.
Hey, he's not getting up fast. Saturn, he looks like he's ready to go, but look at Chavo Jr. He's wildly out there.
Trying to regroup.
He's running out there.
And runs his way back into the ring, and Perry Saturn is ready for it.
He's back at rope.
Back body drop. Chavo Jr., nice balance, lands on the ring apron. And Saturn reverses and sends Chavo face first into that top turnbuckle.
Going to bring him in the hard way.
Going to go up to the middle rope and bring it into the ring with authority with that suplex. And the cup, hook of the leg. Shoulders are down and got a two count for Nick Patrick.
Yes, Saturn had him down. Surprised he didn't try to go for the rings. Must have not had a good position here. But, hey, very aggressive guy. Look at me. Got him on the mat. He's going to keep him there, tying him up. Hey, this is like a sugar hole, man. That back of that neck is straining, brother. That's painful. Saturn let him out of it.
And as we pointed out on so many occasions, Perry Saturn can beat you with submission holds. He can beat you by going to the top rope. So many different ways, so many different offenses that you have to be careful of when you're facing Perry Saturn. But Chavo Jr. had a well-placed dropkick first to the knee, and then that one, I believe, caught him in the shoulder or the side of the head.
I think Saturn, yeah, thought he was coming high. Chavo hit him low in the knee, took him out there. And I tell you, Saturn was going, tying him up. Might have not had him hooked right and let him out, but was a mistake. Chavo started moving. Saturn couldn't catch him, and now he's out there getting up slow.
Whoa! Chavo Jr. with the slingshot into the cross body block as he followed up his clothesline that took Perry Saturn out to the floor. And I'm kind of surprised. Chavo Jr., he's in the driver's seat in this matchup as he rolls Saturn back into the ring. He's got an opportunity to beat Saturn right here.
See if he can hold him.
Gets one, gets two, and Saturn got the shoulder up at the last second.
Yeah, his weight's too low. His weight's over the midsection. Got to be way up over the chest and cradle him up.
And now Chavo Jr. in an attempt to neutralize Saturn, a wear down move at this time. He's trying to maintain his control that he has in the matchup.
Gives you time to think too, feel out your man, but he didn't have it good again. Trying to out-wrestle Saturn may not be Chavo Jr.'s forte.
With impact in the corner. Corner to corner, Saturn takes Chavo Jr. and just T-boned him out of the corner with that suplex.
Not the bone right out of that team.
Springing off the middle rope, flying forearm smash by Perry Saturn was on target. Waits for Chavo to get to his feet. He's going to take him overhead again with another release suplex. And hooks the leg. And gets two and kick out by Chavo.
Hey, Chavo, he'll not give up. And that's definitely a Guerrero trait.
We are waiting to hear from Sid Vicious. The challenge was issued earlier tonight by Booker T.
Wait a minute, I see something hopping.
It's Eddie Guerrero. Uncle Eddie. Oh, he just came out and he took Chavo Jr. down. Perry Saturn just nailed Chavo Jr., but it's almost as if Perry Saturn doesn't want to take the win this way.
Yeah, well, you better turn around or he's going to get something away. He don't want it.
And this is payback for Monday, at least in the mind of Eddie Guerrero, as Perry Saturn beat Guerrero on Monday, thanks to Shane Douglas and his chain. Chavo Jr. just fell forward. He's got a chance to pin him. He's got one, two, and he beat him. Just knocked off Perry Saturn, and if you think about it, it was the interference of Eddie Guerrero that led to the win.
That's Monday night, Perry Saturn. You want to fight fire? Filthy animals can get dirty and filthy too.
Oh, there's problems heating up between the filthy animals and the revolution in general, and in particular, Eddie Guerrero. And this man, Perry Saturn. Chavo Jr. scores the victory. We're live. This is Thunder on the Superstation TBS from Norfolk, Virginia.
Hammer didn't land that hard. He's back in. Nice movement.
Barely a one count that time off the roll-up for Prince Iaukea. What an opportunity this is. The winner of this matchup, and both of these men have amassed good one-loss records in the past in WCW competition. But the winner here, one would think, is going to, well, vault up that ladder of success in WCW. Take it up a couple of notches.
Well, I tell you, you've heard members of the Revolution voice their opinions louder than a lot of other guys, but they're all after the same thing. I mean, a shot at...
Whoa, another quick roll-up by the Prince and another two count.
Yeah, a shot at that gold ring. I mean, you know, fortune and glory, and there's only one way to get it. Get in that ring and chalk up victories. Losers don't make the grade.
Van Hammer that time just out-muscled the Prince. The Prince tried to send him across the ring, and Van Hammer stopped him. Now reverses. Sends Prince Iaukea off of the ropes. Oh!
Way too quick for the Prince, Van Hammer went down way too soon. Prince very quick on his feet, good balance. And Hammer's learning how to use that massive body of his.
Another quick roll up, the quickness of Prince Iaukea, and another two count. That's really what he brings to this match. He needs to out-quick Van Hammer, stay away from moves like that, boot to the midsection, and then an inverted atomic drop.
I tell you, it's easier said than done, but once you get hit with a move like that, it's going to be very hard to stay away from him. Just flattened him.
Almost just stalking his prey, extends the leg, catches the Prince, and sends him down to the mat with the big boot. Now just standing over Iaukea, showing total dominance in this matchup. The Prince looks like he's out on his feet. It takes him up and runs him back first into the corner. And now he's going to hang him to the Tree of Woe.
He's got him hung on the Tree of Woe, but bending him back this way, I mean, the physical body, the bone, skeleton structure, is it made to bend like this, Mike? This is very painful. You have 5 legal seconds to break that.
And Van Hammer does break at 5, although this matchup, as far as the momentum, has certainly switched in his favor. Now back into the ring, Van Hammer takes Iaukea, sets the Prince up on the top rope. We've seen this before. Just takes him out by the head, just by the jawbone, and sends him across the ring. What strength!
That was raw power right there. But Van Hammer's learned how to use his balance. When you got balance and you're planted on the ground, then you can use all the power you got. And right there, just picks him up easy.
Just another example of that power, size, and strength advantage. Drops down across the midsection, and now with a reverse chin lock on Prince Iaukea. Sort of a surprise here that Van Hammer would go this way after he was relying almost exclusively on a power offense.
Well, it seems he uses the power to get the men flat, and then not a very complicated hold there. Very, you know, simple, basic wrestling 101 type hold. But he's such a big man to sit down and crank back on a chin like that. And very good hold for Hammer to use because his body's big and his arms are long.
Again, back to the basics. Van Hammer, 6'5" or 6", near 275 pounds. Prince tries to get back and fight, but you see that Van Hammer just drops down with that 270-plus pounds across the lower back of Prince Iaukea. Van Hammer went for it again, showing how smart he is as he avoided the knees first, but the Prince caught him, I think, that time as the Prince Caught him at, well, maybe with a low blow. Now shoots him off into the ropes by using both of his feet.
Sort of like golf, he got a lucky bounce.
And follows up with a series of right hands, and the Prince has Van Hammer. I don't know if it's temporary or not, but he certainly has him rocking at this point.
IK has got endurance. I mean, if he can keep going, he's got Hammer down.
That's the key, get the big man down, connected with the drop kick. But Van Hammer, you'll see, quickly back to his feet. Look at this move. The Samoan drop, the follow-away slam, gets one, gets two, and Van Hammer kicks out. Surprised that the Prince was able to muster up the strength to take Big Van Hammer up for that follow-away slam.
Yeah, well, Prince is no slouch, but he did it right. I mean, he grabbed it, used his legs to pick up the big man, and right there, Hammer shrugged him off. Oh, what a smack.
Spinebuster style, drives him down to the mat, and Van Hammer says that he now has the control over Prince Iaukea. Let's see if he can put him away. Certainly has the advantage. Going to lock on the Cobra Clutch and take him up into the... Oh, drives him down to the mat with that slam. Legs hooked, shoulders are down, and Van Hammer gets the three count as he quickly went for the pinfall after driving Prince Iaukea to the canvas with the Cobra Clutch slam.
Hey, a lot of people use that Cobra Clutch like a chokehold, kind of a sleeper. You can put somebody out with that. Hammer just likes it. Videos trying to get every angle down here on his opponent to find the weakness, find the opening. Problem is, of course, is Lenny going to be out there with Lodi again?
Well, of course you know he is. That's one of the main things that Evan Courageous is going to need to concentrate on. Yes, he's got a title match. Yes, this man Lenny is his opponent, but you must also keep your eyes at all times.
The criminals, why tax us?
Larry, you're off your soapbox for a second now, and we can talk about the countdown to WCW Mayhem. Look at that. Now 2 hours, 20 minutes, and a few seconds as we count down, because WCW Mayhem, the video game from Electronic Arts, will be in stores everywhere tomorrow, September the 24th. You can go all over the arena to battle your opponent. If you want further information, go to the World Wide Web and check out WCWMayhem.com. Referee Nick Patrick calls for the bell. Cruiserweight title on the line. This youngster from North Carolina, Evan Courageous, 23 years old. He's been spending an awful lot of time as of late in the Big Apple, New York City. Courageous has been dabbling in a little TV work outside of professional wrestling. I'm not sure if you know this or not, Larry, but Evan Courageous made a couple of guest spots on the soap opera All My Children, currently in the running for a couple of future TV and movie roles as well.
Well, TV, movie roles, soap operas, I mean, I guess if you're into that thing, that's all well and good, but that's not going to help you in a career of professional wrestling. Courageous wants a shot at the gold. Forget all the goofy little Mickey Mouse TV shows. Get yourself in the power plant and go over all the submission techniques and learn how to wrestle.
And Courageous on the attack here in the early going. Follows up with punches to the back of the cruiserweight champ. Lenny, we need to step aside for a short break. When we return, more action in this cruiserweight title matchup.
Conditioning gel.
I'll see.
We're back live with Thunder. WCW World's Cruiserweight Championship at stake. The reigning champ Lenny defending the belt against the youngster Evan Courageous, and Courageous courageously fights back. Float over and drove him face first to the mat.
Yeah, Tay's been living up to his name right here, but that's
two and kick out.
That's not going to get it done. I tell you, don't let the pigtails fool you. Lenny is very talented, or he wouldn't have been holding on to that belt as long as he has, with or without Lodi. But Courageous is giving it a valiant effort here. Look at him go.
Springboard into a cross body block. Hooks the legs, gets two in. Lenny was able to escape at the last split second. We make a great point, especially when you think of the competitive nature of the cruiserweights, as Lenny just sent Evan Courageous in midair, and he landed face first across that top turnbuckle.
Hey, Lenny's keeping the pressure on, though. I mean, again, taking a belt away from a champion is very hard to do, and for Courageous,
what is he up to here? Sort of slinking his way into a pinfall attempt. That's all right, I can call it. A two count for Lenny. Courageous back up to his feet. And a series of right hands from Evan Courageous. And he is stopped when Lenny takes the shortcut and rakes the eyes. Shoots Courageous off into the ropes. Stopped him, boot to the midsection. Now lifts him up high into the air. Was he going to send it? Oh, he just dropped him. And there's the cruiserweight champ showboating, posing for the crowd here in Norfolk, Virginia.
Yeah, he's way ahead on points and almost getting a little cocky here. And that's that always leads to a mistake sooner or later.
Now Lenny takes Courageous up into the air. Courageous able to float over and land on his feet. Springs up. Both men went for a clothesline, and both men go down.
Yeah, they both had the same idea at the same time. And see who can get up first here. I mean, this is when the training counts. This is when the endurance kicks in. I mean, all the anticipation.
Anticipation, I got it.
This kid's got to go. I want Courageous to beat this guy. I'm getting sick of Lodi running around out there.
Shoots Lenny off into the ropes. Great elevation that time with the back body drop from Courageous. You talked about his endurance. Evan Courageous has also been working in New York City with an organization called Kick Time. He's working on kickboxing, but it's not to add martial arts skills to his wrestling arsenal. It's to increase his conditioning and his endurance, and that's what he needs if he's going to compete against these cruiserweights. And up on top, Lenny going to try and take him over. Courageous going to try and muscle him back. Can he take him down? Brings him out. Strength that time to apply the power bomb from Evan Courageous. Doesn't go for the pin, however, and I'm surprised at that.
See, again, I mean, I get frustrated watching these guys. They have opportunities. They make such elementary mistakes because they want to win so bad, but it's frustrating for a genius to watch sometimes.
Off the neck breaker, Courageous headed out to the ring apron.
Hey, there's Lodi again.
Of course there's Lodi again.
Put the crime tax on him.
Oh. Courageous, oh, and you see the interference on the part of Lodi that time as he sent Evan Courageous off the top, the cover, the hook of the leg, referee Patrick down, and only two that time. Courageous still had it together, still had enough left to avoid the pin.
He's not giving up a day. It's better to be carried out in a stretcher than give up. He went down, he's got him up.
Reverse to powerbomb, gets two, and no, only two. Duck of the clothesline.
Stop.
Drop kick, and Lenny and Lodi have a meeting of the minds.
Sure.
Courageous off the ropes. Sunset flip attempt. Roll up. Lenny quickly to his feet. Block the sunset flip. He's going to take him up into the air.
But he's trying to slingshot him back towards Lodi,
sure, he's
going to
try and catapult him. But Courageous fighting back, but he couldn't avoid it as Courageous and Lodi just collided and they hit heads.
Yeah, he was trying to hold on and may not have worked here. I mean, Lenny hit a nice move right there, Mike.
Off the full Nelson. Drives him to the canvas and gets the three count. But of course, once again, it was the interference on the part of Lodi that allows Lenny to retain the Cruiserweight title. And yes, the West Hollywood Blondes remain champions. Larry, let's take another look at the replay on this one. It's our 10-10-3-2-1 slow-mo. It's brought to you by 10-10-3-2-1. Dial it to save 50% on calls over 10 minutes.
I tell you right there, Lenny finally got the slingshot in, and Courageous tried to stop him, but didn't work. But Lenny right there hit a nice move. You can see the head of Courageous just snap back. When you snap back like that, you go numb for a while. No way Courageous is kicking out of this one.
Lenny remains cruiserweight champ, still on deck. The United States heavyweight title. You saw the challenge earlier. Booker T will face Sid Vicious. That's right. Sid, the monster, puts the U.S. title on the line against Booker T.
Bring out Lobo. The best two in the
just put these two guys to sleep.
Next up on the Super
Revenge here. Look out. To get on Triple H. And again now, The Rock with that bull rope. Oh, man.
Triple H blocked it. Now he battles back. And Rock goes ahead.
The running power slam by the British Bulldog. And then Triple H with the pedigree. And Triple H is going to Unforgiven. What is Triple H to the Bulldog's relationship?